Hello and welcome. This course is about Git, a distributed version control system. I'm glad that you've decided to take this course, because Git is a very handy, robust, and frequently used tool. Git tracks your project history and enables you to access any version of your file back in time. It also allows multiple people to work on the same project, helping them to edit the same file simultaneously. Git is a distributed, reliable, and fast tool, and it is free. A distributed system lets you work offline. You can make changes without having access to the server that stores the central repository. In a centralized system, anyone who makes a change needs to be given access to the central location. In contrast, in a distributed system, developers can make changes to their own repositories without being granted right access. So managing access is easier in distributed systems. Now, what's the difference between Git and GitHub? To make it simple, Git is a tool, and GitHub is quite a different thing. It provides services that are related to Git. It's a website that helps you manage Git-controlled projects. Next up, we'll be installing Git and running our first commands. In this course, I'll be using Ubuntu Linux, but you can also install it on Windows machine or macOS machine. To install it on Windows, just go to the Git's official download site and download the installation for Windows client. Then run the setup command and install Git with all the defaults. After the installation finishes, you'll be able to run Git Bash, which will allow you to execute all the commands used in this course. In macOS, you have to download and install Homebrew, and then you can install Git using the command line through the following command: brew install git. Now, to install it on Ubuntu, you have to run sudo apt install git. Press yes when prompted, and wait till the installation finishes. To check the Git's version, you can run git --- version. Now we are ready to proceed and set global configuration settings. Let's define a few global settings. The first setting is to define your name, and the second setting is to define your email. To do this, you can run the following commands: git config --- global user --name, and define your name in double quotes. I'll define it as git labs9, which I've created for the demonstration purposes. The next command is git config --- global user --email, and your email in double quotes. In my case, it'll be gitlabs9@gmail.com. Another useful global setting which you can run is git config --- global caller --UI and auto in double quotes. This setting will enable Git to color code the output of Git commands on the terminal. The global setting allows the settings to be applied to any other repository that you work on locally. Now, when it is done, we can check all the configuration settings for your repository by running the following command: git config --- list. Also, if you want to edit any of your configuration settings, you can do so by editing the .git.config file, which is located in your home directory. Let's open up it quickly. We can run the following command: nano or your preferred editor, for example, Vim or Notepad if you are running Windows. But in my case, I'll run nano /.gitconfig. Tilt means that this file is located in my home directory. In case of Windows, the path could be /user/.gitconfig. So I'll run the command and it'll open the file itself. And you can add the configuration settings to this file. After you are done, you have to save this file and close the editor. Now we are ready to create our first Git project and run Git commands. Let's create a directory where we'll store the files for our project. To create a directory, let's use mkdir command. Let's run it with the name of the directory. I'll run mkdir demo. And to change the active directory to the newly created one, I'll type cd demo. These two commands work on all operating systems: Windows, macOS or Linux. Now we can also refer to it as a repository. This directory will contain all the files, and since we are in the repository, we need to initiate Git to start using it. To do this, we'll run the following command: git init. By the way, for you to know, just like git init, all Git commands begin with the keyword git and followed by the command. Let's check this repository with the ls command. I'll type ls-la. Notice this newly created .git directory. All information related to Git is stored in this directory, in this repository. And this .git directory and its contents are normally hidden from view. And the only thing you should know that it is there. Never edit any files in this .git directory. It can corrupt the whole repository. So, now when we've initialized Git, let's add a few files to our repository. You can add any files to this repository, which you consider are good for your learning process. As for me, for now, I'll add one file. I'll type touch file 1. This touch command will create an empty file. Now, when something is changed in our repository, let's see how Git reacts to it. Let's type git status. You have to remember this command because it is one of the most used Git commands. This command shows the status of your repository. It also provides such information as files which are untracked, which are tracked, and what changes are, and which is the current branch, and what is the status of the current branch. So you should use this git status command very often. Now, Git have to know which files to track or which files should be untracked. If you decide to track the file with Git, it'll monitor the changes being made to that file. And on the other hand, the changes to an untracked file are ignored by Git. Now, checking the status of our repository, we can see that one file is currently marked in red, and it is untracked. In order to track this file or files, we can run the following command: git add file 1. In case you want to add the whole directory or the whole repository, you have to run the following command: git add dot or git add dash capital A. It'll tell Git to track the current directory as well as any files or subdirectories within the current directory. Be aware of using this command. because you can end up adding unnecessary files to your repository. Now when we said to Git that we want some files to be tracked and we added these files, we are ready to make a commit. Commit is a sort of a snapshot or a state of your repository in a particular moment of time. You can revert to this snapshot whenever you want and get back to the exact version of this file with all the changes if you need to. So let's run the following command: git commit -m and the command concerning this commit. This -m option specifies that you are going to add a message for you to know what changes were made to this commit. For example, in my case, I'll write git commit -m added file 1. Please note that a meaningful commit message is an essential part of your commit, and it'll be important in the future for you or someone else to know why you created this commit. Some files were added or some changes to the project were made. After running git commit command, please notice the string with letters and digits. It's the hash of the commit, or its identity. This hash is a unique identifying signature for each commit, generated automatically by Git, and you can refer to this particular commit by using this hash. Next up, we'll take a look at how we could use remote repository and how to copy your files to this remote repository, which will enable you to work in a team, or others can access this repository and make use of it. We worked with local repository or local folder. Now let's copy it to a remote repository, which will make it accessible from any place. To create a remote repository, you have to complete your GitHub sign up. You have to visit github.com and create your account. After it is done, you can add a new repository in your account. To do this, click on Your Repositories button in right upper corner of GitHub site and click New. It's a shiny green button. Give your repository a name. In my case, it's demo. Make it public or private and click Create Repository. Now you can copy this newly created link. In my case, it's github.com/gitlabs9/demo.git, and it's using HTTPS. So I'll copy this link and run the following command with this link. I'll type git remote add origin and the link itself. This will configure the remote repository address on your system. If you made a mistake while typing this command or while typing URL, you can remove this remote repository address by typing git remote rm origin. After it is removed, set up the remote address again using the correct URL. You can check the status of the remote address by typing git remote -v. It'll be a good idea to check the address prior to pushing your files, your project, to the remote destination. When you are sure that everything is set up correctly, you can copy your local project to remote repository. This process is called pushing. So to push project to remote repository, you should type git push -u origin, this is the name of your remote project, and master, it's your local project. Typically, the remote repository will demand a username and password, unless you have set it to use SSH keys. When the project is pushed to the remote repository, you should be able to view it. If it is a private repository, you'll have to log into the remote repository in order to see your work. So when it is done, anyone can copy your project and work on it. To download your project, you have to use git pull command. This pull you can consider as download. You can have several remote repositories simultaneously, and to distinguish them, you have to give them different names. Commonly, the main repository is called origin. That's what we used in this command. If you want someone to just copy this repository and have the working version of this repository, they could just clone it by using git clone and the address of your remote repository. In my case, it'll be github.com/gitlabs9/demo.git. Now let's do the following activity. Let's create a new directory where to will clone our remote repository. We'll type mkdir demo clone. I'll change directory by typing cd demo clone, and here I'll type git clone and paste the address of my remote repository. Now let's say that I've made changes to my main local primary repository. So let me change to the directory demo. I'll type cd ./demo. Now I'll create a new file. I'll type touch file 2. Then I'll add this file to my local repository by typing git add file 2. And I'll run the second commit by typing git commit -m added file 2. Now I'll push the changes to the remote repository by typing git push origin master. It'll copy all the changes from my local repository, which is master, to my remote repository, which is origin. Now let's say that someone wants to synchronize these changes from my remote repository to his local copy of my remote repository. To do this, let me first change to demo clone by typing cd ./demo clone, and here I have to issue the following command: git pull origin master. It'll copy all the updates and changes from remote GitHub repository to my local copy. As you remember, Git only tracks files you explicitly ask it to. But it could happen that you ask it to track some files by mistake. For instance, you could issue the command git add dot. And as you remember, this command will add all the files in the repository to be tracked. We have a way to hide certain files from Git that you know you'll never want it to track. To do this, we have to edit .gitignore file. This configuration file is added to the root directory of the repository, and it lists files you don't want Git to track or display as part of Git status. You can add items to the .gitignore file and commit them. By the way, although a file is listed in .gitignore is not meant to be tracked, it's possible that you could accidentally tell Git to track a file that's listed in there. If that happens, you won't get any error message. This is another reason you should avoid running git add dot, as it may cause files to be tracked by Git unintentionally. Examples of files that you might want to add to .gitignore include such files as .exe or samps.db on Windows, or you could exclude the whole directory, the whole repository, by adding the directory to this file. Now let me create a directory called temp and create a file called config.txt. I want Git to ignore this directory, this repository, and this file. So I'll open the .gitignore file with nano editor, and I'll type temp slash and config.txt. I'll press Ctrl+X and save the settings. And let's try running git status command now. And as you can see, these files are not tracked. The output gives us only the .gitignore file. Although it's advised to add the .gitignore file to your repository, you can even hide the .gitignore file from Git. Just add a line .gitignore to the file and Git will ignore this file as well. However, in such a situation, the file will only reside in the local copy of the repository. So that's for you to decide. You can find many .gitignore templates online, depending on the framework you are working on, such as Rails, for example. You may want to browse through this huge collection of .gitignore files on GitHub. These templates serve as handy starting points for new projects. Please keep in mind that you should set up your .gitignore early, because if you add .gitignore file at the late stage of a project and then add some file to it which is already committed, it will still continue to be committed in your repository and tracked by Git. The only way out in this case is to explicitly untrack the file in Git, after which Git will ignore the file. Until this point, we know that Git tracks two files in my repository, file 1 and file 2. And it doesn't track the whole temp directory and config.txt file, because we excluded these files to be tracked with Git with the help of git ignore file in the previous lesson. Now let me change these files by adding some content to it. I'll type host name command and redirect the output of this command to file 1. And I'll type who am I command and redirect this content, this output, to the file 2. After making changes to these files and saving them, let's see how Git reacts by running git status command. As you can see, Git shows that certain changes have been made to two files. We can also see exactly what was changed in the files by running the following command, git diff. The diff command shows the changes that have been made to the tracked files in the repository since the last commit. In the output, we can see green lines starting with a plus sign. It shows what's been added. And the red line starting with a minus sign shows what's been removed. When you edit a line of code, the same thing happens. The old line is shown in red with a minus sign, and the new version of the line is shown in green with a plus sign. If you want to check the changes in a single file, add the file name after the diff command. For instance, git diff file 1. And keep in mind that git diff command shows the changes only in tracked files. Now, after you've reviewed the changes you made, you need to stage the changes to be committed by typing git add file 1 file 2. Alternatively, you can add all tracked files like so, git add -u. Now that you've staged the files, they are ready to be committed. And you can type git commit -m, and I'll type in double quotes, added some info. I must say that it's a good habit to review the changes that you've made with git diff command. and try to never stage files for commit before reviewing. So up to this point we have more than one commit. Let's explore a new area of Git, the history of the project. The simplest way to review the history of a project is running the following, git log. This command shows the commits that we've made so far. The history shows the list of commits, each with a unique hash, an author, a timestamp, and a commit message. This commit hash can be truncated. Usually 5 or 6 characters are enough to identify the commit in a repository. For example, let me copy first five characters of a commit and type git show and paste this truncated hash. And the git show command lists information about a commit. So let's see how short we can go until git fails to identify the hash. I'll type git show and paste first 5 characters. Now let me truncate it up to 4 characters, and git identifies it again. And if I truncate it up to 3 characters, it'll fail. Let's imagine that I've added some important content to my file 1, staged it with git add-u command, and performed a new commit with git commit-m command. But on this point I want to experiment with this file and perform some tests. But on the other hand I don't want to fail anything, because it's in production. That's where exactly we need branching. Creating a new branch in a project basically means creating a new copy of that project. You can experiment with this copy without affecting the original. So if the experiment fails, you can just abandon it and return to the original, the master branch. But if your tests are successful, Git makes it easy to import these experimental elements into the master. And even if you change your mind later on, you can easily revert back to the state of the project before this merger. After creating a new branch in Git, you can create new commits in a branch while not affecting other branches. It is one of the best features of Git. So by default, you are in the master branch, and it is commonly used that people usually expect to find the latest up-to-date code in a particular project in the master branch. So with that in mind, let's start working with branches in Git. To see the list of branches and the current branch you are working on, run the following command, git branch. If you have cloned your repository or set a remote, you can see the remote branches too. Just add -a to the command and it'll look like git branch -a. The branches that colored in red signify that they are on a remote. In my case, I've got just one remote branch and one local branch, which is master. See that asterisk to the left of master? It indicates that I'm working just now on this branch. Now let's create a branch in Git. To create a new branch and stay in your current branch, just run the following, git branch, and I'll name it test. So I'll type git branch test and press enter. However, on running git branch command again, it seems that the active branch is still the master branch. To change the active branch, we can run the checkout command. So I'll type checkout git checkout test. You can also combine the two commands above and thereby create and checkout to a new branch in a single command by adding -b to the checkout command. So you could type git checkout -b test 2. Now if you run git branch command again, you'll see that your active branch is test 2. The branches we've just created are based on the latest commit of the current active branch, which in our case is master. If you want to create a branch based on a certain commit, let's say we want to use a commit A9590, you can run the following command: git checkout -b test old, that'll be a name for this branch, followed by hash. In my case, it'll be A9590. You can rename a branch by running git branch -m temp renamed. It'll rename the current branch to temp renamed name. To delete a branch, run the following command: git branch -D test 2. But try not to delete branches unless you have to, as there is not really any downside to keeping branches, and you have to delete them only if the number of branches in the repository becomes too large to be manageable. Please note that -D option used in above example deletes a branch even if it is not synchronized with a remote branch. This means that if you have commits in your current branch that have not been pushed yet, -D will still delete your branch without providing any warning. To ensure you don't lose data, you can use -D option. This -D option only deletes a branch if it has been synchronized with a remote branch. So let's try running this now. I'll type git branch -d test 1. And git should give you a warning and abort the operation, as the data hasn't been merged with a branch yet. When you first log in, your current working directory is your home directory. Your home directory has the same name as your username, in this case it's temp, and it is where your personal files and subdirectories are saved. To find out what is your home directory, just type ls. The ls command lists the contents of your current working directory. Please note that there may be no files visible in your home directory. That's because ls does not, in fact, show all the files in your home directory to be listed, but only those ones which names does not begin with a dot. Files beginning with a dot are known as hidden files and usually contain important program configuration information. They are hidden because you should not change them unless you are very familiar with Unix. To list all files in your home directory, including those whose names begin with a dot, just type ls-a. As you can see, ls-a lists files that are normally hidden. Many commands like ls and others can take options, so -a is an example of an option. Please note that options change the behavior of the command. There are online manual pages that tell you which options a particular command can take, and of course how each option can modify the behavior of the command. We will now make a subdirectory in your home directory to hold the files you will be creating and using in the course of this tutorial. To make a subdirectory called, say, dir1 in your current working directory, just type mkdir dir1. To see the directory you have just created, type ls. The command cd directory, or cddir in our case, means change the current working directory to dir1. The current working directory may be thought of as the directory you are in. For example, your current position in the file system tree. To change to the directory you have just made, type cd dir1. Type ls to see the contents of the directory. Now, an exercise for you. Please make another directory inside dir1 directory called sub1. You can pause the video, complete the task, and then play it further. Here is a solution for this simple task. Just type mkdir sub1. Now let's cd to the upper directory to dir1 and run the command ls-a. As you can see, dir1 directory and all other directories has got this special directories called dot and double dot. In Linux, dot means the current directory, so type in cd dot means stay where you are, so in this current directory. And cd double dot means the parent of the current directory, so type in cd double dot will take you one directory up. Now try to type it, cd dot dot. Note, typing cd with no argument always returns you to your home directory. This is very useful if you are lost in the system. Now try to type just cd. It will take you to your home directory. Another handy command is pwd, print working directory. If you try to type it right now, pwd, this will give you full path name to the directory you are in, and it will look something like this. The last directory is your home directory, or the directory which you are in, and all the way up to the root of the file system. Dash sign means the root of the file system. Now, another exercise is looking at this result of pwd command. Try to move around using cd, ls, and pwd again command to explore your file system. And remember, if you get lost, just type cd by itself to return to your home directory. Let's move on and type cd to get back to our home directory, and then type ls dir1 to leave the contents of your ls dir1 directory. Now type ls sub1 and you'll get a message like this. The reason is sub1 is not in your current working directory. To use a command on a file or directory not in the current working directory, the directory you are currently in, you must either cd to the current directory or specify its full path name. To leave the contents of your backups or some other directory like sub1, you must type ls dir1 slash sub1. Home directories can also be referred to by the tilde character. It can be used to specify paths starting at your home directory. So type in ls tilde slash dir1 will list the contents of your dir1 directory no matter where you currently are in the file system. What do you think? Ls tilde would do in your command line. So ls tilde will list your home directory, and ls tilde slash dot dot will list the directory which is one level up for sure. Now please try to list the contents of the directory which is two levels up from your home directory. And the solution is ls tilde slash dot dot slash dot dot. Let's recap the commands we used in previous session. Ls. Ls command lists files and directories. Ls-a lists all files and directories. Mkdir makes a directory. Cd directory changes to name directory. Cd change to home directory. Cd tilde change to home directory as well. Cd double dot will change to parent directory. And the final command was pwd, which display the path of the current directory. As you remember, makedir creates a directory in your file system. But what if you want to create a directory and subdirectory with one step? For this, you have to use option dash p. Now let's create a directory dir2 and subdirectory sub2 in it with dash p option. As you can see, it is successfully done, but now let's try to create it without dash p. It will give us an error. You could also create several directories at once. For this, you have to type make directory and then type the names of the directories you want to create. Let's create dir2, dir3 and dir4 with one step. For this, we type make dir and the names of the directories.